Yes, sir. We are live.
Good evening, friends. Welcome to Indian Arthroscopy Society Basic Arthroscopy Teaching Course. We are on our 10th lecture today, and we have Dr. Sachin Tapaswi and Dr. Anshu Shekhar. I think both have done extensive work in understanding the complications of ACL surgery. And if I am right, and Sachin can correct me, I think their treatise has been accepted in ISACOS as well. And this document is actually now available, and their expertise on ACL and probably concluding about the incidence of complications, type of complications which happen in ACL surgery, is something which we must hear it from them. With the ACL surgery being done now very, very commonly in almost all cities of the country, obviously new arthroscopy surgeons have to be aware of basic problems and complications which may happen, and understand how they can probably take care of these complications, reduce these incidence of complications, and if they do happen, how to come up with this problem. Let me welcome Dr. Sachin Tapaswi and Dr. Anshu Shekhar to present their thoughts on this problem. Sachin, this is a very, very informal forum. We would be probably, if you won't mind, stopping you guys in between and asking you questions as they come up. We have members of Indian Arthroscopy Society, Dr. Samantha, secretary, and Dr. Ranjit have also joined in. In addition, a lot of members of IES would join on platform, like Dr. Tejas, Dr. Tirath. They have been regulars in basic arthroscopy course. So they would also raise their hand and ask some questions. In. So it's more like an informal discussion. Over please, to you, Sachin and Anshu.
Yeah, please feel free to interrupt us. And again, thank you for both my behalf and from Dr. Anshu Shekhar. We are really happy to be a part of this basic learning course. And between the two of us, we'll be speaking on complications in surgery. And I think at the outset, because this is a very good academic forum, and now the IES also has our own journal, it is indeed my privilege to also invite you to contribute to the Asian Journal of Arthroscopy, which is now in its fifth year. And I think the issue from this year, this current issue is on multi-ligament knee. So I invite all of you to join and help us. Again, I think what is important is that because of the COVID, we've postponed our meeting to next year, from the 22nd to the 24th of April. COVID will be the same, and we hope to welcome you to next year's event as well. So I think when we discuss what the complication is, essentially it is an undesirable, unintended, obviously, and a direct result of an operation affects the patient. And this probably would not have occurred if the operation had gone reasonably as hoped and reasonably properly. So that's only the definition of what a post-surgical complication is, as is written out for. Why are you getting echo? Can you hear echo as well?
Sir, I don't know. It's from your end, sir.
Yeah, it's from your end, Sachin. And I think some disturbance is happening in transmission as well.
Okay,
sir. Maybe microphone location, sir.
Hello.
Yes. We can hear you, Sachin.
Sir, is something running in the background, sir? YouTube or something?
There's no YouTube running in the background, actually. That's why I thought, why is this happening?
Even you are getting the echo, actually.
I'm getting the echo. Are you not people are not listening? You're not getting the echo, right?
We are getting echo, sir.
Okay, let's just see now. So I think if you look at what actually will be, let me do one thing actually. I'll just stop the share for a moment. One second. I'll just try switching over to headphones and see if that makes it better. Give me one moment, please.
Yes, sir.
Let's start all over again.
Well, we can have a discussion. Dr. Samantha can initiate.
So we have Bhupesh and Tanmay also joining in.
Yeah, okay. Is this better now?
Yeah, much better.
Okay, I think. Okay. So we'll start all over again. And very sorry for that. Okay. Okay, so at the outset, thank you very much, IAS, for allowing us to present some work on complications in ACL surgery. I think it's indeed important that we discuss this very important topic. The reason being is that everybody wants to know about complications, but we all are inherently afraid to discuss our own complications or what we've seen in our clinical practice. And that's why we thought it would be really appropriate to sort of have this particular forum and do a basic teaching on how one can attend to complications, recognize them and treat them as we go ahead. So we'd like to invite all the members who are happy to participate in academic aspects of arthroscopy to contribute to the Asian Journal of Arthroscopy. And we move on with our learning with the 10th anniversary Pune Knee course, now shifted to its new dates from the 22nd to the 24th of April, 2020, with the same format and the same faculty that is coming through. So when we discuss what a complication is, usually a complication is an undesirable, unintended, and a direct effect or a result of the operation that is being performed. And this definitely will affect the patient. And what is also important to understand is that this was an unintended event and which should not have occurred or which would not have occurred if the surgery has gone well and would have been reasonably sort of executed and the outcomes would have been as what we hoped for. So that's basically the definition of an infection, which is written up almost about 12 years ago in the World Journal of Surgery. The truth of the matter is that the dynamic reality is that complications do occur in almost each and every procedure. And overall, if you look at all the complication rates of from minor to major surgeries or supramajor surgeries, an overall rate of 10% complication is a realistic number that all of us should accept and should be looking at. So the patient in question here is a 28-year-old male. He's had an infected ACL reconstruction, which was draining sinuses for almost about 2 years or so. And he actually had to have a three-stage revision, wherein in the first stage, I took out all the dead material, packed antibiotic-coated beads within the tunnels, got him back for a second stage, did a bone grafting procedure. And then in the third stage, we actually ended up doing an anterior closing wedge osteotomy along with a revision ACL reconstruction with an extra-articular tenodesis. Now, if you see his X-ray, he has a broken guide wire in his tibial tunnel. So this actually will account for a complication. But if I look at the result now, he is now 2 years from the following result. He's got an IQDC of 89 and a Tegner activity scale of 5.6. And by no means is he an unhappy patient or does he consider himself to have a complication of the revision surgery. So this is probably the paradox of the definition of complication. This would get reported as a complication, but in reality, I think if you see, he's a very happy and a very satisfied patient. So based on the origin of the complication, you could either have them preoperative, intraoperative, and postoperative. And this is how we'd like to talk upon this important subject. And when we are considering this subject, we're going to look at each and every complication. We're going to be discussing the cause of the complication. We'll look at the consequence, what that means, what does this lead to? And of course, we're going to look at how can we circumvent this problem and try and get a good outcome. So I'm going to hand over now to Dr. Anshu, who will speak on the preoperative complications in ACL surgery.
Thank you, sir. So taking it forward, we'll first deal with the preoperative complications that we can have. Now, preoperatively, what are the things that can go wrong? This is before the patient is scheduled for surgery or just before his reconstruction itself. It can be an incorrect diagnosis of the ACL injury itself. It can be mixed misdiagnosis of associated injuries, or there can be an error of judgment in timing the surgery. So incorrect diagnosis. This typically happens when we do not follow our protocol of taking a thorough history, examining the patient properly, both in the clinic and under anesthesia, and performing proper MRIs or interpreting proper MRIs. Now, this is a PD saturated fat sat sagittal image, which would at a lot of places be reported as a partial ACL tear on the tibial side. Now, this is a 3 Tesla MRI scan. This is not a low res scan. Now, this will raise suspicion in the clinician's mind whether this patient actually has an ACL tear and he might get posted for surgery. Now, see what happens when we do an oblique sagittal scan. So, an oblique T2 sagittal scan reveals that the tibial footprint is completely intact and that hyperintense signal is probably something else. Hence, performing oblique sagittal or oblique coronal images have definite role if your history is not very clear, if your clinical examination is suspicious, or if you are really suspecting an ACL tear which you want confirmed on MRI at any cost. Misdiagnosis, the commonest of these which are missed are a ramp lesion, a lateral meniscus posterior root tear, PLC instability, and an MCL laxity. Now, this is how we need to look for a ramp lesion. This is a hidden lesion, so-called. So we need to advance our scope between the medial femoral condyle, the medial tibial spine, and the PCL. And once we are there at the back of the knee, that is the ramp. Now, this has to be seen in every single case because a ramp lesion can be missed if we are not careful in inspecting and at times inserting a needle from the posteromedial portal and palpating it as well. A lateral meniscus root tear, again, knee in the figure of 4 position, we need to probe carefully and look at the integrity of the root itself and its attachment, which is usually the posterior meniscofemoral ligament. Stress X-rays, again, are extremely important. When in doubt, we need to perform stress X-rays preoperatively or in the OR. There are cutoffs provided extensively on MCL and PLC injuries by Laprade's group. And these can shed light and help improve our clinical imaging. We need to remember that misdiagnoses are responsible for almost 15% ACL failures. Hence, the direct consequence of missing these injuries is actually ending up ruining your ACL reconstruction. Now, timing. A lot is being said nowadays about timing. We do know definitely that late surgery is bad. Late surgery for ACL leads to progressive meniscus and chondral changes and is detrimental to outcomes. However, is early detrimental as we have been classically taught? Not really, if you are to believe the recent publications coming in from Sweden and Austria. So Carl Erickson's group found that acute ACL surgery within 8 days was not found to have reduced ROM and stiffness and was not inferior when we look at the functional outcomes. This paper from Austria, Innsbruck, found that surgery even within 48 hours actually had no extension deficit, no cyclops, and no re-tear rates. Hence, it is important to remember that timing the surgery is important. The knee has to be quiet. We should get adequate range of motion and quadriceps function. The number of days and number of hours really does not matter. I'll hand up to Tapaswi, sir, for talking about the intraoperative complications.
Okay, so thank you, Anshu, for discussing the preoperative issues. And as what we've discussed, I think what was really important to see was that most of the issues were errors of commission, of errors of not being able to initiate and find out what exactly was the injury pattern. So now we moved ahead, we've gone intraoperatively. And intraoperatively, we look at 4 major issues. We look at complications related to graft harvest, related to graft preparation, placing the tunnels, and creating these tunnels by doing drilling, and last, passage of the graft and fixation of the same. So if you look at the various causes where you can go wrong while harvesting a graft, there would essentially be a premature hamstring graft amputation. They would be causing patellar fractures from an inadvertent or a poor harvesting technique of a BTB graft. You could have an amputation of the quad tendon. Or if you go in too deep, then you could go ahead and tear your vastus muscle. And last but not the least, you always have this risk of injuring the infrapatellar branch of the saphenous nerve, which you can see on this dissection right here, which is an intraoperative photo when we've gone ahead to harvest a BTB graft. So for the hamstrings, the major problem is that of amputation. For BTB, it is a poorly harvested graft. Odd or a patellar fracture. For the quad tendon, it could be a premature amputation of the graft, or if you go in too deep, you can actually lacerate the muscle. And for a BTB and the hamstring, you can always go ahead and injure the infrapatellar branch of the saphenous nerve. So how do we do a proper hamstrings harvest is probably, I think, the most important thing. You go about 3 finger breadths below the tibial joint line. You make a transverse incision in the sartorial fascia. You want to dissect with your scissors completely in this plane below the sartorial fascia and above the pes. You want to then go down and create a vertical limb in the pes. So what we've done here is first dissect in between the pes and the hamstring tendons. And then once you've got this flap, I will make a vertical L-shaped or a reverse L-shaped incision. And this will then allow you to place your retractor and see everything properly. The next thing is to hook your mixer, isolate both the sartorius as well as the gracilis, the semite as well as the gracilis tendons. Open the sheath, pull each tendon one by one. So here we are, we've pulled the gracilis tendon. The gracilis will have important bands or attachments to that of the semite. Isolate these bands very carefully in this particular fashion and release them with a pair of good medicine bomb scissors or dissecting scissors before you go ahead and do anything funny in whatsoever manner. So importantly, you have to release. Then we come to the semite. The semite has 3 very important bands which attach the semite to the medial head of the gastroc. The first one is approximately about 3 centimeters proximal to the insertion. And the second one is again a very important one, which is approximately about 8 to 12 millimeters proximal to that. So this is the first band, which is always a very thick band and is a very broad band. And then in this, you will again dissect it out, put in your mixtures and release this under vision. Don't try and do MIS surgery here, because the moment you start doing any minimally invasive surgery and you have no vision, then you will end up having a bad result. The price that you have to pay for a poorly harvested graft is a poor ACL reconstruction, which results in disaster. Patient will not mind a 1 centimeter long incision, but he definitely will mind coming back for a second surgery. So here we are after releasing these 2 bands, band 1, which is around 30 millimeters proximal, and the second one, which is another 8 to 12 millimeters proximal to it. Once you've achieved this, then you can use your closed or open stripper and go ahead and harvest it. What is again important is to close this reverse L-shaped incision that you've made in the sartorial fascia. So this is an example of a poor harvesting technique. You can see that there is a struggle going on there. And what has happened is a premature amputation of the gracilis graft. Again, very rough technique. You can see that there is a lot of pushing and pulling that is going on. The bands have not been released. And whoever surgeon has done that has left behind a very long band, which he then cuts and then sort of retrieves the tendon, which is again a very wrong thing to do. And I think this surgery is going to be really compromised because you have such poor graft source here. On the BTB, the cause is not creating a parallel cut within the patellar tendon. A good way to do that is to use a parallel blade, which can be made commercially available through various companies, or you can make one yourself. It's not that too difficult. And the second important thing is to use a nice sharp oscillating saw blade and create on the patellar side a really nice bullet tipped graft. You can see here that this is the extent where the tendon is finishing and the bone starts. And what we've made is a nice arrow shaped graft, which is really very important, which is going to allow you to have less problems. The consequence of not doing a proper graft harvest is that you end up you know, harvesting a graft, something like this, in which the fibers and the bone plug are completely mismatched. And this will result in a very poor and weak construct, which will then lead to further problems. What will you do when you land up with such a problem? With the hamstrings, I think if you have a graft diameter which is marginally low, then you can think of doing an augmentation with an artificial tape, though this is a point that is open for debate. If you have problems with the bone tendon bone graft, if it is really long, then you can recess it more in the femur. So you drill a deeper femoral tunnel. If it is a shorter BTB graft, then probably you put whip stitches, take in the tendinous portion, take the tendinous portion to the tibial tunnel and use it like a quad tendon graft. And if you end up with a short quad tendon, then you harvest a bone plug so that you can use it as a longer one. So this will be the problems and how you can circumvent them. And that's a depiction where you can use either tape along with your hamstring tendon. One can do an outside in drilling for the ACL so that you get a longer length if you have a longer BTB graft. If you have a shorter, you drill shorter tunnels. And if you have a shorter length quad tendon, then you drill or you harvest a bone plug along with the same. The cause of errors in graft preparation is essentially twofold. Either you use incorrect suture material or you drill very large holes in the bone plug. And the consequence of these is that it results in difficulty in passage of the graft. It will result in graft laceration if you have drilled large holes, and it will also result in compromised fixation, which will then lead to problems that you need to sort out during your circumvention stage. To circumvent these problems, it's important that we apply a few principles. One is that we use high strength suture for graft preparation. Try and use number 2 polyester or number 2 ultra high molecular weight suture, like ultra braid or fiber wire, or you know, there are hundreds of them. Each and every industry has really excellent these high strength sutures. When you're preparing bone plugs, use small drill holes, which should be 2 millimeters or less, because they will not weaken your graft significantly. Make sure that your graft size is absolutely accurate. And for that, please do always use a good graft sizer. We tend to really overlook this particular step, but good graft sizing is really important, because if you poorly size it, either you end up with a very loose graft or you have a tight graft and you have people pulling from both sides to trying to push that graft in, which invariably causes problems. The graft will break or it will lacerate. And if you're using bone plugs, then it's really nice. It's a good idea to use the BTB crimper, which is again commercially available. It compacts the bone nicely and allows you to really nicely tubularize the bone plug. If you're using hamstrings and soft tissues, you can use graft compression tubes as well. So these are certain techniques that one can use to circumvent this problem. The next issue, or the next cause or intraoperative error, is that of tunnel placement and tunnel drilling. And usually the main reason why this happens is that we have a very poor knowledge of anatomy, which I think is not really acceptable if you are setting out to do ACL surgery. But the most important reason is poor visualization. We have our portals, which are too low, so the fat pad obscures our vision, or you know, we've not applied a tourniquet properly. We have a readout, and that's why we can't see things properly. Or if your portal is just, and because it's not in the right location, what happens is that the graft tends to actually go lopsided and this will result in more problems as well. So visualization is the key. If you can't see properly, then you won't be able to actually perform any surgery. So good portals, a good tourniquet, good fluid management, and proper knowledge of anatomy are really very important. Another good helpful thing to use is the use of remnants. So when you have a remnant, you can preserve it and you can use this remnant to guide you to accurate tunnel placement, both on the femur and the tibia as well. And last but not the least, we don't want to use an incorrect technique, and we'll discuss about that when we come to some illustrative examples. So this is viewing through the anteromedial portal, and we palpating the posterior wall of the lateral femoral condyle, and you can see some remnant there which is lying in place here, and we go to the center of this remnant and go slightly more posterior to the same. The ridge is sitting right there, and this is what I feel would be the accurate position for placing the graft. I normally would use an arthroscopic ruler to cross confirm, and this makes it a very good technique. The ruler comes in, you can measure the length from the posterior wall of the notch. The point that I've made is roughly around 6 millimeters or 5 and 6, and the footprint is approximately 12. A lot of us, if we are fond of using offset reamers, need to really decide which offset we should use. So what we're doing here is that we've created this tunnel insertion point at 5 millimeters when the footprint is approximately 12. And now just to show you, when I use a 4 millimeter offset guide, then the point is achieved. And I think that would be good. But the moment I use a 6 millimeter offset guide, then I'm completely off from where I should be, exactly in this particular manner here. And this is the wrong point to choose. So the point that I would like to make here is that offset guides are not probably the best, because one size will not fit all. And then you would need to make an extra calculation as to what offset guide you want, where do you want it, etc. So to the best of my knowledge, I feel that actually looking at the landmarks, feeling them, measuring them is a much better way of getting this sorted out. As you are aware, when you have a malpositioned tunnel, then you are very likely to get an ACL failure. And malpositioned tunnels, more so on the femoral side, are the commonest cause of ACL failure and the reason to have an ACL revision. Again, if you have a partially anatomic tunnel on the tibia, you're more likely to get an ACL failure. So both malpositioned femoral and tibial tunnels are known to give rise to a ACL surgery that fails because of poor tension, impingement, and laxity. The next thing that is important is the position of the knee when you're doing transportal drilling. If you keep a low flexion angle, then you're more likely to get an injury to the common peroneal nerve because your pin exits very low and you're more likely to have a posterior blowout. Now, if you are not able to get good flexion, such as in someone who has a lot of pannus and who has a very thick thigh, then the trick to use is to drill at 90 degrees of flexion, but use a flexible guide like in this particular manner here. And this will allow you to circumvent this particular problem where you are not able to flex your knee beyond 120 degrees. The consequence is that poor flexion while drilling will lead to a blowout. And that's an example of this tunnel, which has experienced a posterior as well as a lateral blowout. And this is definitely not the kind of tunnel that you want to create, though you may find that the position looks not too bad, but still there is hardly any wall integrity. And this will pose a big problem for graph fixation as you start moving ahead. And then this will create problems during the rehab where the patient may lose the strength of his fixation. In such situations, you will need to reinforce your fixation by using additive devices. What we've shown here is the extendo button. And now in this particular individual, you can now remount your suspensory device with an extended augment like the extendo button. And then this can be used to flip over your lateral cortex, and this will maintain the strength and stability of your fixation device. So this is a good trick to circumvent your problem. And it's always pretty useful to have one of these devices lying somewhere in your operating room, because you never know when you need it. And if you don't have it when you need it, I think you're in a big problem. On the tibial side, to circumvent problems like these, it's always a very safe idea to first confirm that your guide pin has come out in the right place. So here the tibial footprint is 14. My guide pin came out at the mark of almost 7. So I'm pretty happy with that. On the medial lateral view, the footprint is 10 millimeters. My guide pin is roughly around 6 and 7. I know here that I'm a bit medial to my liking. And that's why on the tibial side, I will always do a sequential reaming, because when you ream it sequentially, you first start off with a 6 millimeter reamer that allows you to move your guide wire to the correct desired location. And then you can fine tune the position as to where you want your final position to be. And thereby you can achieve a perfect tunnel position. Perfect tunnel position is absolutely important. On the lateral view, you want your tibial tunnel to exit at the amis 42% point on the amis line. On the femoral side, when you draw the Hertel's grid, you want it to be at the one-third junction. In the coronal plane, you want it to be just lateral to the medial spine. So if you place a tunnel in the tibia that is too far anterior, and it is also anterior in the femur, it will result in a graft that impinges in extension and you get roof impingement. If you push your tibial tunnel too far posterior, then you get and you land up with a transtibial ACL reconstruction, which is a vertical graft. So though your patient will have good AP stability, he will have very poor rotational stability. So that's another impingement that occurs. And if you have your tibial tunnel, which is too far medial or lateral, you will get lateral wall impingement, which will again result in a compromise of your ACL stability. So these aspects are really very important, and that's what you need to really understand. The last intraoperative complication issue that we need to discuss is that of graft passage and graft fixation. And this problem can occur if you've not sized your graft properly. So what we've had is that we've probably drilled a tunnel of 9, but the BTB graft is 10. Your graft, your BTB has a very poor bone plug shape, so it can't go inside the tunnel very easily. And or you start struggling and pulling hard, and then you land up with problems where you give aggressive traction on graft sutures. This is one such consequence in which there was mismatch of the graft and the tendon. And what happened was that the surgeon started giving aggressive tension on the sutures, and you can land up with either of these two situations. You can have the endo button that flips right out of the thigh. Again, you must be having a lateral blowout here, or it flips over the iliotibial band, thereby causing puckering and dimpling of, you know, your lateral side as you start flexing and extending. How do you circumvent these problems, especially for the BTB graft? Well, you do proper bone plug and proper graft sizing. And once you've done that, because you want to try and get a bone plug to go over the bend, like how we do in a PCL, we coax the graft into its position. You do the same thing here. You create a pulley with your blunt trocar, lift very gently the bone plug in the joint. You can manipulate it with the help of a blunt trocar or with the help of any suture retriever. And then once you've manipulated it, you very gently coax it into your tunnel. And that's how you would circumvent the problem of aggressive tensioning and aggressive traction on your BTB graft by doing these maneuvers. So I think it's really important that we do and pick up all of these problems and avoid intraoperative problems. We'll now move on to the next section, and I'll get Dr. Anshu to again discuss the various post-operative complications and their causes, consequences, and circumvention.
Sachin, we have a couple of questions. So if you don't mind, if we can have your questions, and then we can go to Anshu.
Yeah, you can do that.
Okay, so first question, which has come on a chat box, is basically to you and Anshu both. You said you guys prefer to do an oblique digital MRI. So the question is, how exactly it is done? Do they actually position the limb in some oblique manner, or they position the whole gently in some oblique manner, or is it a section which they take with their routine MRI scans?
So it's just a standard MRI scan where the limb is positioned in the same manner, but the technician at the back end will angle the image acquisition in an oblique fashion.
Okay.
What you do is, for a coronal oblique imaging, he will take the sagittal image. Can I have that, please? Just drop up. So for
maybe if we can, I think, you have unshared. If you unshare the screen, so we can probably see you.
It is unshared right now.
Okay, perfect. Now that's
it. Yeah. So the ACL runs anteromedial to posterolateral. That is the plane, correct?
Yeah.
So when you angle it in the plane, on the coronal plane, when you angle it medial to lateral, the sagittal images that you will get will be oblique sagittal images. On the other hand, when you look at it from a lateral view, it goes anterior to posterior. So if you angle it in that plane, this plane, so I'll just show it again. If you angle it in the plane of the ACL and take your coronal images, you will get an oblique coronal imaging. Okay. So again, to look at the coronal plane, you go to the sagittal plane, you angle it in the angulation of the ACL, turn around, and this becomes your new coronal plane. And that will give you the entire length of the ACL. So that's how
we need to specify every time, or they would do it?
So I think it is really very important. A lot of our knee work and shoulder work is very imaging dependent. And because of the same, it becomes really useful to have, you know, a good rapport with a couple of centers where you know that you have someone who's interested in doing this musculoskeletal work. And as a matter of fact, then they will do it routinely for you. It doesn't, you know, the acquisition time is the same. They don't have to do anything different. It is just during the reading and capturing of the images, they will just change the, you know, the plane of the image acquisition, and they will give them to you.
Perfect. Another question is, any tips and tricks while assessing the lateral meniscus root tear? So
to assess the lateral meniscus root tear, the first thing is to have good visibility, and you need to be able to palpate it properly. So to be able to have good visibility, keep the leg in a figure of four, but don't hyperflex the knee to hyperflexion. If this is my leg, this is the heel, keep the figure of four just so that the operated leg ankle is sitting on the opposite side. That gives you enough area for you to look at the lateral meniscus root. You can see it nicely through your anterolateral portal. You can palpate it with your hook probe through the anteromedial portal. But many a times, the hook probe will obscure your view.
Yeah.
So if you want to really look at everything properly, a mid-patellar portal, where you actually make your viewing portal bang through the middle of the patellar tendon, you can put your leg in a figure of four like this, and then you are able to put your hook probe through the lateral portal, see through the medial portal, and that will really help you in a great manner.
That's a very, very good. Another question is, if this endo button, as you showed, flips out of the skin and you just pull it back, and as you said, it actually sits over the ITB, is there a way out? Do you need to really cut it up and then make it, place it back, or is there any minimally invasive way to bring it back to the bone?
Yeah, so I think if you have realized it before you fixed the tibial side, everything is salvageable. So there are two scenarios: that you have realized it before you have fixed the tibial side. In that case, once you give traction on the tibial sutures and you start moving the knee, you'll find that on the lateral side, the skin starts getting dimpled in as you start moving it, because it tethers the ITB. The moment you see that, stop, put your scope in the joint. I will pass my scope to the anterolateral viewing portal. I will go ahead and in this area here, I will put a needle arthroscopically, make a new portal, remove the synovium here, and I will ask someone to just gently tuck the graft. You can see where the movement is, and then very carefully, you will go ahead and see where the button has flipped. You can see the graft coming out, or you can see only the sutures coming out. When you see this, give a tug on the tibia. If the whole ITB is coming in, then stop. Don't try and do any MIS thing. Then straight away go, increase, make a lateral incision large enough, at least about 2.5 inches. Put proper retractors under vision, layer by layer. Go ahead, make a decent incision in the iliotibial band. Pull down, it will fall down. And once you fall down, then you close it back properly and come. If unfortunately you have noticed it after you have fixed the tibial tunnel, then the best option to do is to pull hard on your sutures here, keep them under tension, and put an additional bio screw in the tibia, then open laterally, see how far the tunnel, how far your graft and fixation concept construct has come out. If the graft is at the mouth and the loop is outside, you can put an additional suture disc and use the loop and tie it down. If the graft has also come out, then just cut everything and forget it and rely on the intra-articular screw of the aperture fixation that you put in.
I think with this buttons which have got a variable loop, this problem is much more common.
Because you don't get that sensation of flip.
Sensation, yeah, you just pull it up.
Yeah, and in that context, what is really important is that you should really size your tunnel properly, and you should take that extra 15 seconds and mark and look at that. A very useful trick, if I'm using an adjustable loop, is that I actually make this portal well beforehand. I see my pulling suture and I pull the button and flip it under vision always.
That's a very good idea. Very good.
So for adjustable loops, we have two marks. One is that, you know, you have the intra-articular methylene blue mark, and I always confirm the flipping under vision, because, you know, you just don't get that feel that your fixed loop has flipped.
I think that's a good idea. You can dissect that area, and then it is much easier, because then it, you can see flipping
probably
under vision.
Takes about 2 or 3 minutes more. All that you have to do is to make an additional portal, remove the synovium, take a radio frequency or a shaver device, see your pulling sutures, and then just pull it under vision, and the chances that you'll go wrong are quite less then.
Yes,
Vikas has a question. Vikas, if you can unmute and ask you directly. Vishal Kasliwal, you can directly ask, and then Tanmay can also directly ask. Don't type it. You can ask with Sachin directly.
Yeah. Sir, hello.
Yes.
So usually we have a difficulty in assessing these partial ACL injuries. They reported as partial ACLs, you want to augment it with remnant preserving. But there is some amount of difficulty in exactly assessing which is the torn part, which is the intact part. Any tips and tricks to properly assess partial ACL injuries?
So partial ACL injuries will be of two types. You will either have a single bundle tear or you will have a partial tear. So going clinically and assessing them, you'll find that these patients symptomatically will not be complaining of instability and buckling. They'll be having more of pain. If they have a AM bundle tear, and the whole thing flips anteriorly, they'll usually get loss of extension. The AM bundle you can assess by doing your drawer test. The PL bundle traditionally is assessed by doing the Latchman, but that is really not true. In today's ACL world, there is very minimum importance given to the drawer. In fact, if you look at any scientific publication, nobody even discusses drawer test anymore. There are only two things that are considered. One is the Latchman and the other is the pivot. So you'll find that a lot of these people will not have a very good pivot shift because it's a low grade injury. They may or may not have a Latchman sign. Once there is any suspicion that you do have a partial ACL tear, which you feel clinically, because the patient will typically tell you in the history that whenever he's doing any pivoting activities, he gets pain, but he doesn't feel buckling or he doesn't feel instability. That should suspect you to have that. Also, when he engages in exertion, he will keep getting these effusions, which stay for a couple of days and go down. Once you've seen that and you order for an MR scan, the best thing to do is to specifically say that give me oblique plane imaging, because an oblique plane imaging will clearly show you whether it is a single bundle tear or a partial tear. If in doubt, the next thing to do would be to do a Porto KT dynamic MR scan, but I am aware that it is not available in other cities except Pune right now. How do we clinically approach them? Never harvest the graft before starting the arthroscopy. Go in, do the arthroscopy, do arthroscopic visual assessment of your laxity, palpate. First do an EUA, of course, you'll do an exam under anesthesia. Then do an arthroscopic examination, palpate the stump, palpate the ACL, see it both in a figure of four position for tautness of the PL bundle, keep it at 90 degrees, try and see if you can see an arthroscopic drawer, take a ruler, measure the footprint, see if anything is deficient. Once you've done that, you will have a clue whether the ACL has got a lambda healing, which means that whatever ACL was torn is stuck to the PCL. In that case, you need to do a full grade ACL reconstruction, harvest both your tendons or whatever you want to do. If it is a single bundle tear, which has been proven, then probably you'll just need to harvest one soft tissue tendon, and that will be that could help you circumvent this problem. But never harvest the graft beforehand.
Great. I think Tanmay also has a question regarding partial ACL. So Tanmay, you can directly ask.
Yeah, and remnant, actually, yeah, that was a nice talk, Dr. Sachin and Dr. Anshu. I just need to ask Dr. Sachin that you showed that for your all your cases, probably even with the remnant preservation, you would be, it's difficult at times to measure the exact footprint on the femoral and the tibial side when we are in acute cases or when we are doing a remnant preservation. Then this is fine for the youngster, but then maybe how to manage to measure the footprint, or I mean, how would you go about it when you want to do a remnant preservation and you cannot exactly measure the footprint by a gauge?
So if you want to do a remnant preservation technique on the tibia, then the best thing to do is to get your ruler, see where the mark is, use an elbow MR device. Don't use a tip MR device. Use an elbow MR device, and with an elbow MR device, you go 2 millimeters more posterior to where you want, so that you actually see that wire coming up. Stop there, bring your ruler in again, see whether you're at the right place, and then you start creating sequentially your tibial tunnel. On the femoral side, the ideal thing to do is to use an intraoperative CR and mark out the grid, but that tends to be a lot more tedious. So to preserve the femoral remnant, I use a 8 millimeter sharp osteotome. And with that osteotome, just how like you use it for a periosteal elevator, you start, you know, you will start on the front of the footprint here and start pushing it from front to back so that you have created, like how you make an osteoperiosteal flap, you make a flap of the ACL, correct? So you've hinged the femoral insertion and you've exposed it. You have your meniscus repair device. You have that, half pipe or half spoon, which comes with your knee at 90 degrees, put the half pipe or the half spoon, hinge it on the posterolateral corner of the femur and now flex the knee. So this half pipe protects your ACL stump and it exposes the footprint. Once you've seen that, then the best thing that I do is that I take the same size reamer as my graft and I put it on the footprint and then drill my Beath pin through and through. So here we reverse it. We don't do Beath pin, cannulated 4.5 and femoral diameter. You put the whole thing on, you pass the Beath pin. Now you do your femoral tunnel drilling, take it out, and then you do your 4.5. And then once you've pulled your graft in, this whole flap will just fall down and it will not cause problems.
Sachin, on the femoral side, it is easier to preserve, but on the tibial side, it is difficult to preserve the footprint.
So for the tibial side, there are actually two things that one can do. One is that once you've passed your wire through and through the tibial footprint, grab it with a coker and then gradually dilate it. Before doing that, once the guide wire comes, I take a 15 blade and I make a vertical incision with the 15 blade on the tibial stump. So vertically going from anterior to posterior, exactly where the guide wire has come out. Then through this, your reamers come, so less damage is done. After that, pull back the guide wire. You have that little fish mouth that you have created. Take a dissecting scissor, let it come through your anteromedial portal, pass it through this and dissect underneath the stump. Correct? So you go from anteromedial underneath the stump. When you're retrieving the suture, you need to retrieve it in two steps. From the femoral tunnel, you bring it out in the front and then you pass it underneath the stump and pull it down. So I'll just see if I can share a video of that. I'm not so sure if I have it right now with me, but if possible, I'll just try and see if I can do it in one moment. So that's how you would do a remnant preserving ACL surgery on the tibial side. Yeah.
Meanwhile, if you're looking at, I think Bhupesh has a question. So Bhupesh, you can ask
questions. Yeah, Bhupesh.
Sachin sir, when you're looking at it, I will just ask Dr. Anshu quickly. On the preoperative points that we discussed.
Yeah, one second. Yeah. So this is a preserved remnant here. Correct. So we've released the ACL from the femoral footprint. So coming to the tibial side, now you bring in your 15 blade. Correct.
Yeah.
You make an incision there, then bring in a dissecting scissor, pass it underneath through this in this particular manner, so that it comes out behind there. Okay. And now you will use a elbow tip aimer. This, I didn't have an elbow then, so I've used a tip aimer here. You will drill sequentially through the tip aimer, taking care not to destroy. Then you want to put your scope through the tibial tunnel and ensure that you drill through and through, because you cannot visibly see that thing coming out. And now this is how you will retrieve your suture. You will pass a curved hemostat, pull the suture from the femur to the joint. That's passage one. And this is passage two from the tunnel down below. And once you've done this, then you can preserve this whole remnant. And now you can pass this graft in its entirety. Below, you can see this blush of blood going through, which means that the graft has passed through. And pull it up. At the end, if you want to be fancy, you can close this up with a PDS suture or a Vicryl suture, just in case you have nothing else better to do on that day and you want to really look very smart in your surgical work. So you can just tie it down there so that you've closed the mouth. And now you can see that this is a completely preserved remnant in this particular fashion here. Your ACL graft is hiding somewhere beneath that, right there.
Yeah,
and that takes care of it. I know, I just leave it here. Dinshaw likes to put two suture anchors in the femur and he likes to tie that remnant there as well. I know a couple of Korean surgeons who also put, you know, I think they put one and two suture anchors here and they tie all of this there as well. So, yeah.
But thank you. This is a very good technique, actually. Thank you.
That is just digressing from the topic.
No worries. Rupesh, you had a question.
A very quick question on preoperative evaluation that you mentioned.
One second. I'll just give it to Anshu. Preoperative
evaluation. Yeah, yes, sir.
Can you tell us what are the red flags of history? Because you quickly mentioned about the history taking and we have to be very meticulous.
Yes.
Where can we go wrong? Because my intent behind this question is there a way that the patient can never complain of injury, but MRI shows an ACL tear or a ramp? I mean, is the velocity of the injury so small that it could just be a sprain that he has forgotten over the years? Can such a history prop up in your experience as it happened?
Yeah, I think ACL sprain is more than a clinical, it is a radiological diagnosis that we get.
He's just sprained his knee,
so yes,
radiologically ACL tear, Latchman positive. Has the patient ever given no history of injury, which is evident to him, but you end up finding a Latchman positive, you send him for an MRI and...
Yes.
So, I'd be worried if I have such a patient. Does it happen in true life? Because I have one patient like that and I'm really confused. 13 years and one patient I have seen with no clinical history of... no history of injury, but MRI shows tear. And I really don't know if I should touch him.
Yeah, so if these patients who do not have a clear-cut high-velocity injuries, low-velocity injury ACLs, who do not complain of ACL, and if you're saying your patient is just 13 years old, so I think these are what have been described.
Patient is 33.
33, okay. So if the patient does not have instability, the MRI shows a tear, there is no clear history of a high-velocity injury, I think these patients should be conserved first. You know, they are the typical COPERS, a poorly understood entity. But yes, we do need to consider low velocity injuries, especially in the OBs. Yeah, this is a very well described entity, ultra low velocity injuries in the OBs who would just maybe slip while walking, never complain of instability, and you examine them. They do invariably also have high Batten scores, generalized ligament laxity. So we need to be very careful in these patients because yes, almost no velocity injury can cause ACL tears in them. So this is where, you know, dynamic assessment using an MRI or objective assessment using, there's so many applications now, of course, not available freely with us. They do have a role.
Thank you. Any other red flags in history that we should be worried about?
Well, I think one thing which we can confuse with an ACL instability is patellar instability, right? So patients says that, you know, he felt his knee popping and we examine and we say that, is this a Lachman test? And the MRI again reports as, you know, query sprain, query partial rupture. We have to be very careful in looking for patella apprehension sign when we are examining them. We have to examine the other knee also. If that has an asymptomatic patella maltracking, we have to look at rotational alignment in these patients. So... yes, it is just a holistic approach.
Thank you so much.
So Rajiv has a question to Sachin or to Anshu?
Sachin, sir.
We need to give headphone to Sachin first. Sachin, Rajiv has a question, and then we have three questions on chat box after Rajiv, and then we go to the presentation.
There is Ranjit also, I think.
Yeah, I think Ranjit also has a question. So Rajiv, you can first. Then Ranjit.
See, technique use was excellent. Passing the graft through the SCL remnant. The only thing is that sometimes we tried that the graft is get stuck when we are using adjustable loop, because once it crosses, sometimes it's stuck with the fibers also, and it's very difficult to pull the graft towards the femoral tunnel.
Adjustable loop. Adjustable. When you are preserving the remnant.
Yeah.
So one thing that I've been routinely doing for several years is that once I've prepared the graft, we take 3-0 monocryl sutures all around the graft, so that we bundle all the collagen together. One of the things that may happen is that if you have your individual strands sort of staying out, then that could get caught. Another thing that is really important is to really clean the mouth of the tunnel properly, especially the femoral side. In the tibial side, because when you pull, the tip of your soft tissue graft elongates, you know, like a little bullet, so it goes through quite easily. So I think that could be one of the breakaway points from it. And as I said, when I'm doing an adjustable loop, I will always ensure that I visibly see the button come out on the lateral cortex, and then only I'll try and tension it.
Ranjit.
Yeah, Dr. Sachin, very nice presentation as usual. As we all know that apart from locked knee and etc., our usual time of surgery is usually when the knee becomes silent. Now, with the recent papers of early surgery and aggressive rehabilitation and very good result, what is your opinion? What is your usual time of surgery from the time of injury? What do you recommend?
So, whenever the patients need it, we will do surgery. If the patient is unstable on day one and the knee is quiet, I don't hesitate in asking the patient to undergo surgery on day one. Previously, we thought that when there was bone marrow edema, your screw would not take hold. That is wrong. That really doesn't go through. The bone marrow edema, essentially, pattern is going to tell us the type or what was the force behind the injury, nothing more than that. Whenever the knee is able to do 80% of movement compared to contralateral, he's got 80% of strength compared to contralateral, then the knee is ready for surgery, whether it be 3 days, 3 weeks, or 3 months. So I think time as a number has gone now, to be very honest.
Yeah, Tejas, you have a question?
Yes, sir. I have a question regarding the preoperative evaluation and the during operation. First question, do we regularly drain the hematoma to start the movement in ROM?
So if the hemarthrosis is very tense, it is painful, and when he comes, he cannot even contract his quadriceps, then you may drain the hematoma, he may aspirate the hemarthrosis for pain relief. If there is a mild to moderate hemarthrosis, then there is no point in draining it per se. So there is no routine hemarthrosis drainage unless and until, you know, you are doing it for a diagnostic purpose when you want to differentiate between hemarthrosis and lipohemarthrosis, or you are doing it for a symptomatic reason when the patient has got severe pain, is unable to move the knee, and cannot even initiate contraction in his quads.
Perfect. Same continuation to that question, Arun Gupta has asked, what is your threshold to aspirate the knee after ACL reconstruction, post-ACL reconstruction?
Post-ACL. That's a good question. So at the end of 3 weeks, if I find that he has a grade two effusion, which means that there's at least 40 to 50 mils of effusion, I find that he's not able to fire his quads. I find that, he's slow on his rehab because his quads are not working well. I find that he's not gaining movement because of the same. Then I will quickly call him for a hemarthrosis, for an effusion, for a aspiration of his, Yeah.
Okay. So Vivekananda.
If we are suspecting infection, then of course.
Then early.
Very early.
That's okay. Vivekananda has got 2-3 questions, but first question is that do you use C-arm sometimes to see for flipping of the button, because then this complication of button overshoot would be much less. Do you use it, or do you recommend it? Why can't you use it?
You can certainly use it, but I feel that whole process of calling for the C-arm person to come in, he comes, search for him, drape it, bring it, move aside, you know, bit of so-called compromised sterility.
Absolutely.
I find it easier to just mark the graft, you're dead sure, And best is to see it there. Yeah. You have to make one extra portal. It will take lesser time than the CRM to come in, actually.
Perfect. Another question which he has asked is, how much of a physiological contact of a reconstructed ACL would you accept to the lateral condyle at the notch? So lateral wall impingement. Some physiological lateral wall touch is always there anyway.
Yeah. So the ACL footprint, if you see it, the ACL footprint extends up to 2 to 3 millimeters, about 4 millimeters short of the articular margin. You are never able to reconstruct the whole footprint. If the footprint is 12 millimeters, you're able to reconstruct 8-9 out of it.
If you can now, show it on a model, Sachin.
Yeah, I'll just find out. If you're, what is very important to see is that when we, which presentation will we have it? Okay, I'll just check. Anyways, so
on the model, yeah, that should be.
Yeah, okay. So now here, when we look at it laterally, the distance between the articular margin and the ACL stump starting is about 3 to 4 millimeters there. What is important to understand is that just as we use that ruler, when I see that the notch doesn't look nice and you, I will measure the width of the notch as well. And then the last thing that you want to do is to create a graph that is larger than that notch. So if for some reason you are not happy with the width of the notch, measure it very quickly. It takes not even 10 seconds. And make sure that your graft is not oversized for that. Or if the notch is stenotic, then early in the surgery, do a notchplasty without any problems. You know exactly how much notchplasty you need to do. My graft is 9 millimeters. My notch is 8. I'm going to remove 3. So all that I have to do is to see the 3 millimeter mark, take a radio frequency probe, just mark where it is, and start it beforehand, not do it afterhand. I'm scared of doing it afterhand, because once you start doing it after your graft is fixed, then you can go through the graft, you can harm the graft, you can lacerate the graft, you can damage your graft. And that's not the time when you want to do this, for sure.
Samantha has a question. I think Samantha has been, it's done. If you already answered.
So Samantha sir is saying, stop, go home now.
I don't have a question. I just listening to you. It is so
okay. So, let's proceed then. I think you have sorted out all the questions which were on the chat.
Yes. Okay. So, we go to the last part of the presentation? I'll show over to you.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
One second. I'll just put it up.
All right. So, now we'll talk of the post-operative complications. Things which we face after the patient has gone home and he comes back to the clinic. These can be infection, loss of range of motion, problems related to graft donor site morbidity, hardware related, patient can have persistent laxity, or he can come to you with venous thromboembolism. So infection has been broadly classified as early when it occurs within 2 weeks, late when it occurs beyond 4 weeks, or it can be just superficial surgical site infection, which is seen in about 0.94% cases of ACL reconstruction, or deep infection, which is seen in almost about 0.2% of ACL reconstruction. So infection is not a big problem incidence-wise, but when it does happen, it really destroys the entire surgical work. Now, risk factors for infection have been found to be higher in male patients when it is done at a younger age. Prolonged surgical time, primarily because it increases colonization in the surgical field. Hamstring grafts have been found to infect more frequently than BTB graft. Again, the reason is not really known, probably related to the sutures used for hamstring graft suturing. Morbid obesity, indirectly, probably because it increases surgical time. Tobacco and steroid use, because they, of course, are known to inhibit wound healing process. Now, when we talk of infection, we cannot, forego this excellent work, which was like the Eureka moment in infection management, or rather prevention, done by Chris Vertulo, where he found that infection rates dropped to almost zero by simple vancomycin wrapping of the graft. This has to be standard of care for every single ACL reconstruction. Vancomycin 500 milligram in 50 ml of normal saline, the graft has to be wrapped and kept while the tunnels are being prepared. Your infection rates can go down to negligible or zero. So how do we pick up infection? We need to look at clinical features, serology, and aspirate it early, never wait for it. Fever, erythema, effusion, loss of range of motion, and discharge. Of course, it becomes apparent that we're dealing with infection. ESR is not a great marker. CRP, especially more than 150 in the titer on day 3 or more than 20 on day 15. And when in any doubt, just aspirate. We should never think of not trying to aspirate for the fear of introducing infection. If it is a purulent aspirate, we know it is infection. Always send it for cultures and counts, total count of more than 100,000 with more than 90% polymorphs is again indicative of infection. You can start therapy before the culture. So when it does happen, it can present as this, just synovitis or frank purulent pus as soon as you put on your trocar. So what do you do when you get an infected ACLR? Remember, antimicrobial therapy is usually sufficient for superficial surgical site infections. This is, of course, after draining your joint, aspirating your joint, and confirming that there is no intra-articular infection. If there is intra-articular infection, you must go in for a prompt arthroscopy, do a thorough synovectomy, debride all the infected and dirty looking tissue, but always try to preserve the graft. And the graft can be preserved in the vast majority of cases if we intervene early. Of course, if we find that the graft is already necrotic and the arthroscopy is delayed, then we need to take it off. Also, after the first arthroscopy, after a suspected infection is performed, we need to check the CRP after 72 hours. And if it has not showing a downward trend, we need to repeat arthroscopy and maybe at this stage, get rid of the graft. Also, a lot of this philosophy is derived from joint replacement experience. Prolonged antimicrobial therapy, which is culture based for at least 2 to 3 weeks IV and then 4 to 6 weeks orally, must be started for every single patient. When we talk of loss of range of motion, there is general tendency to say that, you know, this patient has developed arthrofibrosis. However, we need to understand that arthrofibrosis is a wastebasket diagnosis. Most of the times it is a diagnosis of exclusion. We need to pick up causes which are responsible for loss of ROM. Things like graft impingement, improper graft tensioning, development of a cyclops lesion. These are specific, treatable, well-defined conditions which are not arthrofibrosis. So that is a huge cyclops which will cause a fixed flexion deformity. This is a patient who had undergone ACL reconstruction almost 8 months prior, not attaining proper ROM, not able to extend the knee. And there we see the screw is right inside the joint. We failed to retrieve it because it had broken off. Ultimately, it was taken out. So the screw was impinging in the roof. And then once the screw was out, we see that even the graft is impinging. So there is a roof impingement because the ACL tunnel is too anterior. So there you see on full extension. And then again, the graft is impinging laterally as well. So this is a graft roof impingement, graft lateral impingement. The hardware is outside. So multiple causes of impingement. So this is, of course, this patient did have well-defined arthrofibrosis and the MRI also. So this was a combination of arthrofibrosis plus all those treatable causes. Now we need to understand that arthrofibrosis is a real problem and occurs in almost 5% of ACL reconstructions. Performing early surgery, of course, there's caveats alike. We should not be performing surgery in an angry knee. Young patients more likely to undergo arthrofibrosis. Females, post-operative hematoma. BTV grafts and cord tendon grafts have been found to be more frequently associated with arthrofibrosis and meniscus repair. Now, these are poorly understood risk factors, but they have been proven to increase rates of arthrofibrosis. So what do you do when you get a patient who has lost range of motion? We need to understand that loss of motion in the flexion range is better tolerated than extension deficit. So if the patient has about 10 degree lesser flexion than the opposite knee, probably you can just counsel the patient and get over with it. Extension deficit should not be acceptable at all because it changes the gait pattern. It increases loads on the medial joint and the patellofemoral joint, leading to wear on these areas. we should always search for a probable cause before calling it an arthrofibrosis and treat this cause. So how do you prevent loss of range of motion during your surgery? Remember, timing is extremely important. Do it only in a quiet knee. Technically, always avoid graft impingement and achieve proper graft tension by all those tips which sir has just discussed with you. In your rehab, remember to initiate early range of motion when you do your ACLs and brace in extension. Now, this is, of course, some people are trying not to brace, but we believe in the philosophy of bracing in extension initial 3 to 4 weeks. It goes a long way in preventing loss of extension. Once you get it, how do we treat? There is an entire spectrum. Most patients can be treated with manipulation under anesthesia when physiotherapy fails. Some do require arthroscopic adhesiolysis, but there is a small minority who might require a formal arthrotomy anteriorly and posteriorly if there is a hamstring contracture as well. Now, if the patient has to undergo an adhesiolysis or an arthrotomy, it is most beneficial when done within 8 months of surgery. Delayed surgery can lead to permanent loss of motion, more so because of arthrogenic inhibition of the quadriceps. Oral steroids do have a role when there is flexion loss, but extension loss is usually a structural problem. Now, when we talk of graft donor site morbidity, most of these are because of sensory deficits, because of injury to the intrapatellar branch of the saphenous nerve. Any graft, any technique can cause sensory deficit in the distribution of the IPBSN. Anterior knee pain, again, more frequently seen with BPTB graft, one major cause why people don't go for BTB grafts. And of course, scar related, like hypertrophic scar or a keloid formation. Now, anterior knee pain or kneeling pain has been a fear associated with BPTB. However, there is plenty of evidence now which proves that over the midterm and long term, it really does not matter. The rates of anterior knee pain is not just because you have removed a plug from the patella. There are so many things. There is fat pad resection. There are poorly understood factors, and anterior knee pain is similar between the two graft types. If we really want to prevent sensory disturbances, then we need to adopt minimally invasive techniques. There is a steep learning curve for these. There is the technique by Prodromos, which is described for the ACL, where he goes into the popliteal fossa, or there is a minimally invasive technique for BPTB harvest, which is popularized by Dr. Arumugam, which is great to learn and practice. Hardware related. Now, this is again, this is completely surgeon's fault. If you put in a screw which is right inside the joint, then you really cannot blame anybody else. But if you get cysts because of your bio screws, especially if you use PLLA screws, this is avoidable. This is, of course, avoidable. Now, remember that hardware-related problems can cause an unhappy patient even if your surgery was absolutely perfect. But infrequently, it can also cause an ACL failure and require a probable revision surgery. Now, how do you circumvent these problems? Titanium screws are great. If you do not have inhibition, if your patient does not have inhibition against titanium screws, they have been found to be working great with hamstring or BTB grafts. If you are to use bio screws, it is advisable to use modern generation bio screws, which are HE coated or composite materials. Or if you want to just get rid of the screws, suspensory fixation works absolutely fine with ACL reconstruction. Persistent laxity is again a problem of poor surgical technique. If your fixation was not adequate, if your screw size was not adequate, if your tensioning graft was not adequate, it can lead to persistent laxity in the post-op period. Missing collateral injuries, a grade 2 or a grade 3 MCL injury which was not healed or was not tackled adequately, a PLC injury which was not tackled adequately. Anterolateral rotary instability is now understood much better. Again, adjustable suspensory loops. There is a lot of debate about, you know, loop type A being superior to loop type B. Of course, these are all proven in animal studies. There is no real data available that using a particular type of loop actually compromises fixation. So that is a gray zone for us. So what happens when a patient gets a persistent laxity? He can have mild kinesiophobia, or he can end up with an ACL re-tear. Some patients develop frank instability, and some patients do not return to sport. Now, this is really distressing for somebody who's the sporting kind, not being able to return to sport just because you could not be very particular with the surgical technique. Now, identifying and treating anterolateral rotary instability is extremely important, especially in the young, especially in those who are engaging in pivoting sports, especially if you have done a large meniscus resection or if you have diagnosed a high posterior tibial slope. There is plenty of evidence now from the stability trial that these patients, these subset of patients do well when treated with an extra-articular reconstruction using the iliotibial band tenodesis. Or of course, if you are a fan of ALL reconstruction, you can go for that as well. But ALRI must be suspected and treated. Venous thromboembolism, not a big problem with ACL reconstruction. Very low symptomatic DVT and pulmonary thromboembolism rates. However, we have to be very careful, especially if patients have a history of tobacco use, if your surgical time has been very long under tourniquet, or if you're performing a concomitant osteotomy, an HTO with an ACL, these are definite risk factors for a post-op thromboembolism. So whatever data we have, there is no real support for routine thromboprophylaxis, irrespective of the risk factors. All we can do is mitigate risk factors. We can advise smokers to stop smoking a few weeks prior to the surgery. We can keep a surgical times low, tourniquet times low, and of course, be very careful when we're doing an osteotomy with a ACL reconstruction. And when these patients do develop a DVT or a pulmonary embolism, it is best to refer to your vascular colleague who will do the needful. So these are the post-operative complications that we have. So to conclude, I will hand over the mic to Tapasvi, sir.
So I think what is important is that don't take ACL surgery lightly. It is not something that is, you know, easy, quick fix, and I can do everything properly. You got to be very alert pre-op, inter-op, and post-op as well. Look at the cause, why you are facing a complication, why you have been called on to look at a complication. Look at the consequence and look at the various circumventing ways to get out of this as well. And what is important is that all of us need to have a backup plan for surgery. Like I said, I always have one extendo button which is lying in my OR. I don't think I've used it for several years. It must have expired also. I'll get it changed. But you need to have a mental, physical, and financial backup plan, which is important. And as with any complication, what we always see are the good results, which are the tip of the iceberg. But once you look at the dark secret, which is the complication, I think it is a lot of devastation, frustration for yourself. The patient starts looking at you with suspicion. There may be litigation, and ultimately there is a lot of humiliation. So thank you very much for having me over here, both of us rather, and spend some time with both of you, all of you.
Sachin, just two, three questions before we conclude. One question is, we are audible to you, Sachin?
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, so one of the video which Anshu was showing where there was screw which had gone inside and there you removed the fragment of screw and still there was anterior impingement which was there, the roof impingement. So would you just maybe do a bit of notchplasty and get away because the graft seemed to be pretty okay, or would you actually go ahead and revise the whole graft?
Yeah, so we didn't really show you the whole case, but she presented with a very stiff knee 4 months from the date of surgery. And, you know, she had a flexion of 10 to 40. So I ended up actually, she had everything there. The screw was long, there was roof impingement, there was graft impingement. Her graft was under very high tension, which was not allowing the flexion. So we went in, we dissected
the whole. Revised it completely.
Yeah, we released the whole capsule and we did a posterior capsular release also completely. So she required the whole lot, just to say.
So do you have any video offhand? I mean, just asking that of a small posterior release, which you said, because a lot of these patients have a fixed flexion deformity. So if you do a posterior release, you are able to extend the knee. So do you have a video probably on your laptop if you can share or maybe?
Let me just check.
So that's a small, minimally invasive posterior medial incision. Is that true, Sachin, which we are discussing?
Oh, yes, actually, you could do it arthroscopically or open both.
Okay.
Let us just check if it is there. Okay.
Two, three questions more as you are searching. One question was, is an age a criteria for you to choose a patient for ACL 50-55, fresh ACL without any OA? Would you?
So I think, you know, even if it...
And unstable knee. Symptomatic, yeah. And unstable knee. You would do it.
So even if the patient is old, uh-huh, and the patient has symptoms, really doesn't matter. So the patient that we did today was around 55 years old, but he was little before that. He was just not coping at all.
Perfect. So point taken. Another, yeah, question is, minimal length of graft would you accept in a tunnel? So it is 15 or 20 or 10?
At least 15.
At least 15.
Yeah.
Perfect. Third question is, how many times have you seen, probably everybody would have seen that you have a very good, well-fitting ACL, but on a clinical examination, post-operatively, it comes out to be a grade 1, grade 2 lax, but not symptomatic. So that's a normal thing with hamstrings, isn't it?
I think so. And I think we should not get too hung up about it, because all of us, a lot of our patients will have, there we go. A lot of our patients will have symptomatic laxity. And, you know, it's, as long as you have a hard endpoint, that's perfectly fine. There's no problem there.
Last question. In girls which have got a bit of hyperlaxity, maybe around 10 degrees hyperextension, breaks to, so that they don't land up in an FFD, or even if they are neutral, they are not happy.
Yeah.
So, tricks to avoid that problem with young girls.
Yeah. So, I think in those patients, I'm not so sure. I'm not able to find this right now. I'll just see if I can find it later on. I'll share it with the group. Okay. So, in these patients, you want to get them out to what they started off with.
Yeah.
For this, two quick tricks. One is to try and place the tibial tunnel a bit more posterior than what you would do normally.
Okay.
Second is that my preference is to use a quad tendon graft for them. I don't prefer to use a hamstring graft. If you choose a hamstrings graft, then you will have to add an internal brace. So that just makes it a bit more complex. Then you have to tension it at a different flexion angle. So the way to do this is to push the tibial tunnel slightly more posterior, tension the graft in full extension, and in them I will add an extra articular tenodesis to prevent the, you know, secondary re-rupture of that graft.
Long question. Tirath, you can directly ask the question. Tirath, unmute and ask. Hello. Directly to Sachin. Yeah.
Yes.
Hello. Good evening, sir. I wanted to know, once we have measured the footprint on the femoral side and on the tibial side with the ruler, does that guide for the final diameter of the graft?
Yeah.
And we have to, how much percentage of the footprint that needs to be filled up with the graft?
You have to fill no less than 60 and preferably 100, but that becomes very difficult. The reason being is that your footprint is not a circle, but tunnel is a circle. So if you want to create a footprint that looks like the natural footprint, then you'll have to use the rectangular blocks. And then you'll have to go to either a BTB or a quad tendon graft. If you're using a hamstring, then you will drill circular tunnels. And in those patients, you have to ensure that you get up at least 60 to 80% of the area that should be covered. Once you measure the width, you know that you should not be going beyond that diameter, which is very important. Otherwise, you know, because you've got good hamstrings, you create 6 stand graft, it is 11. And the poor chap's footprint is 9 millimeters. And then you remove the, you know, anterior lateral meniscus root, you remove the tibial spine, and you start causing all sorts of damage there. So measure the width or the breadth of the tibial footprint. That gives you the maximum limit as to how much diameter you should be getting. And you should be easily at least not less than 60 for sure, but minimum of 80% is what I normally try and reach.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Sachin. I think you have answered each and every question brilliantly. Thank you, Anshu and Sachin, both of you. You guys have been wonderful.
Yeah.
I must thank everybody on the panel, because this was really a very, very interactive webinar. And we are happy that everybody is raising thumbs. So Thank you very much, Sachin.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you to all.
It was always a pleasure to listen to you, especially learn small new tips, which are actually
super joining.
Thank you. I think, Sandeep, we can just show the next webinar, which is there on the... So on the 7th, we do have a webinar. The president of the Swiss Society, Shoulder Society, is with us, Dr. Alexander Lederman. He's going to talk about a very basic topic, which is frozen shoulder, which affects all of our practice daily. I think we have heard quite a lot about frozen shoulder, but it is always good to revisit and get the international perspective. He's going to talk what is the latest happening and where are we today. It's at 5 o'clock. The time happens at 8 p.m. On the 7th of August. That's 5 p.m. It's because of, I think, Swiss time that we had to be doing it a bit early. So please do join in on 7th August at 5 p.m. to hear the views on frozen shoulder by Dr. Alexander Lederman. Thank you very much again, Sachin. Thank you all the members of Indian Arthroscopy Society and the panelists. And Anshu, thank you very much. It was indeed a wonderful interactive webinar. Thank you, guys.